Listening Library presents Lei and the Invisible Island by Malia Maunakea. Read for you by Jennifer Robideau. To anyone who has let a mistake keep them up at night, apologize and then forgive yourself. Missing Pieces. Apparently, goddesses were sore losers. Lei sat with Tūtū and Ilikea at the small kitchen table loaded with her favorite foods, pondering her recent life choices that got them stuck here. Here being back at Tutu's house in Volcano Village, yay! With her best friend and ancestral guardian Kaipo, double yay! But without the pendant that would keep him safe as an ʻaumakua, quadruple infinity boo! Lei stifled a yawn as she snagged a pineapple chunk from the bowl in the middle of the table with her chopsticks and dipped it in her poi. The nightmare had come again last night and jolted Lei awake, Kaipo crying out at the hands of Pele and her henchman hawk, Io. It took hours to convince her brain it was safe to go back to sleep. Served her right. Maybe her tūtū had forgiven her for picking the sacred lehua blossom and angering Pele, the fire goddess. But Kaipo, how could he possibly forgive her after what she did? Lei stuffed the fruit in her mouth and strained her ears. Nothing but silence from the back bedroom where Kaipo had been lying the past 2 days, healing. The poi-covered pineapple piece lodged in her throat. She forced it down, her eyes watering. Laying her chopsticks across the edge of her plate, Lei rubbed her forehead. She hadn't meant to get her best friend and family ʻaumakua captured when she picked Pele's flower. And she definitely hadn't known that Pele would take Kaipo's pendant. Now he was an ʻaumakua in distress, his body acting like he was a mere mortal, complete with slow-healing wounds. Lei tried using her mo'o scale, a world-class healing agent from an ancient giant lizard-like animal, but wasn't able to fix him. No one was sure why it worked for her, but not for him. Worst friend ever. Lei snapped her hairband on her wrist, punctuating her thoughts. Tūtū gave her a look, and Lei straightened her shoulders. The last thing she wanted to do was change Tutu's mind on the whole forgiveness thing. She needed to be helpful. She needed to find that necklace. What if Makani goes and spies on Pele? Lei wondered aloud, thinking about her favorite playful wind. Maybe they'd find out where she put the necklace. The wind tugged twice on her hair, clearly pleased to be included in the plan. Ilikea frowned, the white plumeria behind her left ear bobbing as she forked the remaining chow mein from the center serving dish onto her ceramic plate with one hand. Her other hand fiddled with the new ivory-colored bat pendant hanging from a black cord. It was a gift from the snow goddess Poliahu for Ilikea's role in Kaipo's rescue, evidence of her graduation to a full-fledged ʻaumakua with the ability to change shapes. Lei felt herself staring at the girl, searching for signs of her familiar bat form. Her hand movements were a little erratic, her eyes were still black. Her thick hair darkened from a rich, golden color around her face to not quite black as the wavy ends reached her mid-back, the flower behind her ear where the white patch of fur used to be. The girl spoke up between bites. I mean, yeah, cool, another chance to become flesh-fried. Sarcasm wrapped her words. Then she lowered her fork and made her eyes really big, like a genius idea had just popped into her head. Or, hear me out on this wild and wacky thought. We could all stay far away from that fiery mess and never go up the volcano again. Let bygones be powgons. It isn't pow yet, though. Pele made sure it isn't over. I'll go back up myself if I have to. Kaipo isn't getting better, Lei insisted. Maybe it was the lack of sleep blurring away the chaos and making the solution seem crystal clear, like looking through an old scuffed snorkel mask and only being able to see the fish right in front of her. Only the missing necklace was the fish, and Lei needed to catch it, get it, find it, whatever. Her brain was swimming. She just needed to hold it together long enough to get Kaipo back to normal. Then maybe he'd forgive her. Then maybe the nightmares would stop.
You are not going up the mountain, Tūtū said.
Lei flinched at the finality of her tone. I've got to do something.
Pretty sure we all know your chances of coming back alive a second time are slim to nada, Ilikea said before stuffing her mouth with a final bite of noodles.
Lei sighed. Apparently, Ili had an attitude as a bat and as a girl. Tūtū patted Lei's shoulder as she pushed herself up from the chair to get the semi-full pan of noodles.
Eat, eat, get plenty more.
She scooped more onto the serving dish.
Here's the thing, Tūtū continued. Time is of the essence, yeah?
Lei looked back at the refrigerator. The calendar, hanging from a hook suction cupped to the side of it, showed a vibrantly colored illustration of a large, dark-skinned woman surfing above the current month of June. The big red circle around next Saturday that had seemed so far away last week now seemed like it was sneaking up fast.
I know, I fly out in 2 Saturdays.
There were only about 2 weeks left of Lei's vacation in Hawaii before she'd go back to Colorado. Back to the life where she was formerly known as Anna. This time, she'd be stepping off that plane proudly as Lei, her Hawaiian name. Dad'd probably be thrilled she was owning her culture.
That's not what I mean, Tūtū said darkly.
Goosebumps crept up Lei's arms, and Makani blew out of the kitchen and hid in the curtains, causing them to billow.
I went go to the library this morning to do some research on the World Wide Web. Never found nothing. So I asked the librarian, you remember, Mr. Chalk?
Lei nodded. The older Asian man frowned a lot when he was in the adult section, but did the best voices for cakey storytime.
He went help me search the Olelo Hawaii Nupepa, the Hawaiian language newspaper archives. Found this.
Tūtū pulled a folded piece of paper out of her pocket and smoothed it on the table next to her plate. Tilting her head back and looking down her nose, she held the paper at arm's length to read the words out loud in Hawaiian before translating.
It's a mo'olelo.
The author tells the story that everyone knows about how when there is death to the kino, body, the uhane, soul, separates and heads to the lena'a ka uhane, the leaping place of the soul.
Everyone knows that? Lei wondered. Ili pointed at her with a chopstick. The story that when a person's body dies, their soul jumps from the leaping place? Duh. Maybe if you stuck around more, something might stick in your brain.
Lei whipped toward Ili, eyes narrowed at the bat girl. She shrugged in a, yeah, I said that, way.
Guilt gnawed at Lei's ribs. If she didn't know the basics, what if she made another mistake and screwed everything up again?
Tūtū glanced at Lei around the piece of paper, pawed under her breath, then went on.
The soul, guided by ʻaumakua, makes it to the leaping place and begins the journey to becoming an ʻaumakua themselves. If an ʻaumakua doesn't guide it, the soul can become a kueva, a wandering spirit.
Okay, that seemed straightforward enough. ʻAumakua guides souls to the leaping place so they can begin their own journey toward becoming ʻaumakua. Without the guides, souls could become... Wait a minute. Lei remembered that word. Kueva. She peered at Ilikea, who was now very focused on lining her chopstick up perfectly parallel to the edge of the table.
That's what you called me when we met. You said I was a kueva, a wandering spirit.
She turned back to Tūtū. Wandering spirits don't seem too bad.
Tūtū narrowed her eyes at Ilikea.
The worst thing that can happen to one's soul is to be abandoned. Wandering alone, without one community, they turn into nasty buggers. Real rotten. They're not something to mess with.
Lei swallowed and looked at Ilikea. Ilikea stuck out her chin, defensive.
Yeah, but had you met you? You were kinda awful.
That stung. Yes, she was the screw-up. They'd already established that over the past week, and Lei thought they'd move past it together. But something seemed off with Ili. She'd been feistier than usual since she'd arrived for dinner. Maybe she didn't want to help search for Kaipo's necklace. Maybe now that she had graduated and could turn human, she had to get back to watching over her own family. Lei chewed her lip. She hadn't thought that she'd have to do this without Ely's help. But as her mom always said, life is what happens while you're making other plans. Besides, if she could survive 6th grade without her best friend Ridley, she'd be able to survive this without Ilikea. She opened her mouth to let Ilikea know she appreciated her help, but understood if she needed to attend to her family. But Tūtū interrupted.
Eh, no matter. Focus.
Tūtū put the paper down.
The story goes on to talk about how those kueva start to rot. And as they rot, they mess with people. Best to avoid the places they haunt. But in the article,
the author's brother went go look for the spirit of his best friend's auntie, who went pass away small kid time. The best friend was worried the auntie went get lost and asked the brother for help. Tutu paused, pursing her lips.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.